And we're back, guys. This is the second game of the ESCC 2015 at Tier 2 Chinese Tournament. $40,000 on the line. We had yesterday already the first round of the winner bracket. Today, the second half of it, EP came back with two amazing games. Actually, the second one was just amazing. But yeah, Newbie kicked down to a victory or lot in the loser bracket. And here, Tong Fu was already waiting for them. I actually have to say, Newbie and Tong Fu in comparison, I think Tong Fu is the harder nut to crack. Because Tong Fu's performance was amazing in the round robin. They came out of 6-1, so they won 6 out of 7 games, while the other teams, they were struggling on a 5-2 and 4-3 score. So yeah, Tong Fu definitely the favorite to take this tournament, but well, you saw it. EP can easily upset any other team that might even on paper look better than them. Michael Loris is going to sleep because we have also today another grand final, a best of 5 in the Game Show Invitational on Hitbox 17 CEST, that is in 10 hours pretty much. I will be casting it with Michael Loris, so he's going to sleep, and I get a new co-caster, which is Mr. Plek at a British Power coming in.
Bing Hefler, it's been a little while since you and me have teamed up, but let's see what we can get this morning, eh?
Yeah, well, so I don't know how familiar you are with Chinese Dota, because I casted so much Chinese Dota in the last some days that I'm like so into it at the moment.
I'm quite fond of the Energy Pacemaker lineup. They can throw some, let's call it curveballs, the way of quite a few of the more known teams, and it's very entertaining to watch. The style of Dota they play especially.
Yeah, well, at the moment, it's always, I mean, the basic calls they always go for is Queen of Pain, Gyrocopter, the Shadow Fiend, as well as the Storm Spirit, and the Lash Shark, of course. That's what they always try to get through as in calls when it comes to roaming and laning, Clockwork for the offlane, as well as Tusk and Undying. Like, you can put money on this, that this is either banned or picked. Like, all of these heroes have 100% ban or pick rate within the first four. So, and it actually happened. So, Storm Spirit is out, as well as the Tusk and the Clockwork. The Wisp is kind of the odd man out here. Usually does not happen in the first one, but I guess against EP they don't want to have it. The Queen of Pain is not picked, which means either she's getting banned or she's getting picked by Tong Fu. That's the highest chance here. Leshrac, Shadow Fiend. Well, that's a good combination. You have a magic and a physical core. Or I guess Shadow Fiend is kind of a mix for the early game where the races play a bigger role.
Well, as far as I can think with this kind of draft, if they're going to play the Undying Gyrocopter style, it's going to be up to Energy Pacemaker to really hold back that kind of onslaught. Leshrac can go a good way towards that as long as Gyrocopter doesn't get an early BKB. Hell, BKBs in general will be the death of the Energy Pacemaker lineup, in my opinion.
Yep. So, we're gonna get... Oh, that's actually interesting. A Phoenix Envisage ban by Energy Pacemaker. So, I guess they know Tong Fu better than we actually do. Also, the Earthshaker is 100% ban and pick in the Chinese scene, apparently. Now, of course, there is space for the Queen of Pain. I don't think we're gonna see it on the Energy Pacemaker. They rather pick the Shadow Demon, where we have a setup for the Leshrac split Earth. But for Tong Fu, I very, very much think we're gonna see the Queen of Pain.
The Queen of Pain would make quite a bit of sense here. If the BKBs are going to be a problem for Energy Pacemaker in general, Queen of Pain with added burst against Shadow Fiend, Leshrac, they kind of force at least BKBs in response. I mean, that kind of burst damage you really can't go up against without a BKB, especially with heroes like SF and Lesh. They just don't have the health pool in the early game to survive. You're going to be looking for Yules, maybe an early mech, but BKBs would be the ideal. Even though the ult is pure, it'll stop so much more of the damage.
Yep, definitely. So, while they think about it, do they actually want to give the Queen of Pain away? I mean, if the Leshrac goes in the mid and you push the Shadow Fiend in a safe lane, the Shadow Demon could actually rotate, and the Queen of Pain with the low HP pool might actually fall victim to a Leshrac. Some harass damage before, disruption, split Earth, another lightning, some right clicks, maybe even the curse on top of it that might do the trick. Well, it's not coming out. We get the Finger of Lulz by the Lion. Still, I can't believe the Queen of Pain even survives that long into a draft, as in, like, not being banned or picked. But let's see, maybe Tong Fu just doesn't want to give away too much. The Lion, of course, might be a candidate that can take out the Shadow Demon really fast before he comes out, or he just puts the damage on top of one of those cores, plus whatever else. What I'm kind of afraid of is the Undying, for sure, because so far we only have seen very, very strong undyings except for one game. The tombstone is just, if the positioning is right, if the HP is right, the zombie army is always taking you down.
Well, that's the thing. In any kind of scenario where the tombstone goes down, you have to do one of two things. You either kill the tombstone or you don't fight under the tombstone. Fighting under the tombstone and ignoring it, you lose the fight 9 times out of 10 just because of those zombies. They are so bloody ridiculous, especially in the early game. But now Tong Fu helped themselves to the Viper. So Viper Strike, pretty good against Shadow Fiend, especially considering the magic resistance as well from the Corrosive Skin. But now going into the final bans, not even banning the Queen of Pain for either team here. This, as you say, is very odd. I mean, it could be ignored, unlikely, but what do you think we're going to see for the final two picks? We get the Dazzle for MG Pacemaker, but what for Tong Fu?
Well, Tong Fu now has a second core. They put the Viper in the mid, the Gyrocopter in a Trident. I'm not sure. Tong Fu might actually play a dual lane setup here. They have done this before. Now, the Ancient Apparition is out and the Winter Wyvern is out. Usually, you see the one picked of them and the Ancient Apparition being banned out because you want to prevent that the AA ultimate is screwing with your Cold Embrace. That's not gonna happen here. Instead, they're gonna get the Dazzle. But even there, it helps actually that the AA is being banned out. It would have been quite nice, so the Shadow Wave would actually be completely nullified. I'm not so sure what I think about this Beastmaster. Like, what is the Beastmaster actually for? I think his only focus in this game is the gyrocopter. On everything else, I'm not sure it's even worth it to use your ultimate.
Well, the ultimate's such a short cooldown. Early game, you can take a good amount of control with it. But yes, primarily you're going to be looking to lock down the gyro, since the gyro is probably, and I can say with 9 out of 10 certainty, going for that BKB. But we get a spider. Now, I don't like spiders, and I don't like brood mothers. So this will be an interesting one. And just jumping back a little bit in time, Hefla, I told you there would be no spider in Serbia.
Yep. Well, today you have spiders. Funnily enough, we have many five pick or five or like fifth position broodmother bans here in this tournament. I never really paid attention to it because mostly they went for something else anyway, or it would have never fit. This time, an energy pacemaker, they decided to go for something else for the Winter Wyvern, which would have probably been a nice pick for Tong Fu overall. But yeah, the Broodmother is coming out. They're gonna take this chance. If you think about what does EP actually have against Broodlings to really take them out? Of course, the Leshrac, but well, the Leshrac is not always in the lane where the Broodmother is, so that might actually become really fast a problem. So let's look at what we got here. Energy pacemaker again. We have Lee on the Shadow Demon, Old Chicken playing the Shadow Fiend. We're gonna find him in the mid. LT, the Dazzle Fan on the Leshrac. It's the first time I actually see him on the Leshrac core, I think, this tournament. Oh, he always played something physical. This time it's I think the other way around. Beastmaster, he's gonna focus, as I said, probably on the Gyrocopter and yeah, played by Xiaolii. Let's look on the other side.
Of course, on the flip side of the coin, for Tong Fu, on the Undying, you've got LPC. On the Gyrocopter, you've got ZinQ. Viper by UUU9. Up in the top lane, we do have Kabu playing the Lion. And finally, in the offlane role, we have the Spider Zex Bingo.
Yep.
Now, you were saying about the Broodmother and her counters. The Leshrac, sure, you can mention the Lesh. They've got the Razors and they've got the Shadow Poison as well. So they do have some ability to clear the spiders, but my bigger worry is what happens if the spiders go on the Shadow Demon? He's pretty much dead.
Yep, that's the biggest concern, obviously. Like this tri lane, unless they really get some nice vision into it, it's just gonna be horrible for the Shadow Demon. Then again, I'm pretty sure EP is very determined to make the life of that spider very miserable. The first sentry is already up, that gives vision. Well, half of the net is actually covered. She still can go around here, but I wouldn't be surprised if we have a sentry around this area or higher up, that you also have her like chasing down in that area. You have to see what actually happens. But for now, well, we have a normal rune split pretty much, and now we go directly into it. There is an aggressive ward in the mid, which is very interesting. That means we have someone harassing that Shadow Fiend for sure.
Speaking of harassment, ZinQ up on that top lane did try to trade blows with the Beastmaster. They come out about even. And one thing I will point out on this bottom lane involving the Brood, Lee actually invested in a Quelling Blade on the Shadow Demon, and he's cut down all of these pesky trees over here. So when it comes down to putting a sentry, it's going to be very nice in dealing with the spire there. And for a 200 odd gold investment, this Quelling Blade can do quite a bit in favor of the energy pacemaker lineup.
Yep, and at the moment we have the Lion actually going for a little one-on-one versus the Beastmaster, but Beastmaster is a high armor target, so your right click's not gonna do too much. Oh, there are some raises on the Viper, but Viper, damn it, so tanky. Old Chicken at the moment is on 0-0, not a single right click. This Viper Undying Lane, it's just too much cancer to actually play against. You have Decay being spammed on you, you have the Viper. This is even a Viper without, say, corrosive skin. And yeah, he just keeps on punching through. Decay keeps the stacks up. And, well, there's the first blood on the Broodmother, which I completely missed because it was so fast.
Yeah, no one likes spiders and energy pacemaker. They really are ramping up their aggression on this lane. The sentry is just the use of the Quelling Blade, a very aggressive sentry nearly under the tower. It's going to be a very rough lane for the spider. But squishing the spider is never a bad thing.
Yep, but as expected, the second sentry came out and it was closer to the tower, so they can actually chase her up to that position, even a bit into the tower. Now, well, Shadow Fiend is starting to make some CS, but this is just with level 1 races. It's not really not looking good, but at least the Undying finally left the lane. Where is he now? That's a good question. He's circling around. Is that like some bottle snipe attempt? I think it's a tiny bit too late. If the courier doesn't come within the next 50 seconds, we're gonna have a flying anyway, so... well, he's trying it, I guess.
It would have been very rough as a melee hero to get that snipe, either way. Even with the boots, it can be quite nasty. I suppose it's before the 3-minute mark, so it is walking, but all it takes is a little bit of quick reactions inside of Energy Pacemaker to save that courier.
Yep, and ah, look, there are my bun rates here, the ones I've been talking about. Well, it's not quite 100%, actually it's 96, but oh, top race, go on, the Beastmaster, the Rocket Barrage doing so much damage already, and even that last hit wasn't required, there was a next decay sooner or later available, he's not getting out of there. So there's the revenge, Tong Fu, making it 1-1.
It was necessary, in honesty, and if you want to put a kill on anyone, support-wise, it's going to be Cabu, because if he can get an early Blink Dagger, Blink Hex is going to be a real threat in this game for Energy Pacemaker to contend with. Speaking of threats, though, U9, just forcing Old Chicken back in his place under the tower. It's a 6-for-2 Shadow Fiend. That is a really sad Shadow Fiend versus a 19-for-12 Viper.
Yep, the Viper's totally dominating the lane at the moment. Shadow Fiend sits on 7. Souls. The Undying is sitting permanently in the lane, just threatening to come from the back, for example. A Tombstone on an already low Shadow Fiend is pretty much killing him. Like, the Viper can just follow him, and he also goes for more points into Poison Attack, which is underlining his aggressive style at the moment. So, 3 points, the Shadow Fiend cannot run away. He doesn't even have boots at this point. Like, it's an empty bottle with 4 branches. GG, you cannot escape.
Mm. And take a look at LPC, he's being very aggressive again, positioned again behind that tier 1. Is he really threatening to rotate back in on the Shadow Fiend? They do have that Tombstone, so he could, but no, he's going to go back up towards that top lane, and, well, it seems that it's going to be the job of the Undying to be the man behind enemy lines, and just placing the wards, getting the vision up, they can now see that Beastmaster. Are they going to do anything about him, though? They are diving past the tower. Do we get the stun? That's the question. No, they're going to be a bit too far back. Still, the Beastmaster eats the flat cannon damage.
Yep, I mean, they apply a lot of pressure on this tower now. Some creeps actually come back to this tier 1 tower, so they can get some hits in. The new creep wave is coming, so the Cardi, the catapult, is also standing in place to actually do a lot here. And as long as those two on the sidelines, he cannot get close. There's the stun, the tombstone is up, more damage, and the zombies will alone take you down, but Gyrocopter is there just to secure the damage. So that's the second kill on the Beastmaster, and with that tombstone keeping the next creep wave busy. This is definitely a tier 1 tower going down. It's just a range creep left, but he should have the damage. Then again, on the other side, do we have an early point in Diabolic Edict? No, it's not there, but they didn't even need it.
No, not with the amount of force they've put onto this bottom lane. The Broodmother cannot come anywhere near the creep wave without risking death. And it's what you really want to do, put fear of death in a Broodmother. It will be a tower for a tower exchange near enough. They do pop the fortification on the energy pacemaker side, but still, down it goes in Gyrocopter's pocket, and we're even map control wise.
Yeah, when it comes to lanes, like, you can definitely call both tri-lanes as completely one, both early pressure, and they shut down the Broodmother really heavily. Like, she got 3 CS, and those 3 CS were just with spawn spiderlings as a spell. She never even got to hit anything. The Beastmaster did a tiny bit better when it comes to experience, I guess, and CS. He got 8 CS, but still, like, the lane's pretty much in favor. What's, of course, bad for EP, besides, of course, being a kill behind, is the fact that the Shadow Fiend is not doing well. Old Chicken versus Viper, especially with the pressure of the Undying, that makes it the third lane being a loss for EP, and that gives Tong Fu the advantage here. We have to see at what point this sort of equalizes when the Viper goes also in another lane. If she dies there, then it's kind of even. Maybe that creates some space for the Shadow Fiend. Let's see. At the moment, he's just happy with what he gets, like jungle stacking. We saw Old Chicken last game already on the Storm Spirit, where he had a similar lost lane. And then he went with his Storm Spirit into the jungle and compensated for his bad laning, pretty much.
True, you can certainly stack up and burst farm with the Shadow Fiend. He is capable of catching up, but my bigger worry... Yeah, there we go. Beastmaster falling again, this time to the cooldown.
Jesus, and he died so fast at that cooldown, actually. I did not see this one coming. Was this with... This was even without Rocket. This was just movement speed of Face Boots versus Tranquil Boots. And now, was it even a disconnect? I don't know. Tong Fu is pausing for... unknown reason. There's some blinks coming. The Broodmother is pretty much standing on her own sentry ward, hoping that that protects her against whatever else is coming out as Envision. We have only, yeah, only one sentry ward here and no reinforcements in vision, which means so the Broodmother at the moment is kind of safe. But we have, yeah, Dazzle already has new sentry wards in the stash.
Now, just coming back to the Gyrocopter for a second, take a quick look at him. He's got more than enough gold. He's already got his full Dominator on top of Phase and a Wraith Band at 7 minutes. This is going to be a ridiculous game for Zinkyu if this farm continues. From this point on, I'm thinking possibly going into the Yasha even before the BKB. He doesn't really feel any fear in this game at this point. Sure, there's been no big 5-on-5 team fights. We've not seen any roars, but this is just a dominating performance so far from Zin.
Yeah, definitely. So 7 minutes in, the Gyrocopter is already pressuring the tier 2 tower. Well, the Beastmaster should be safe here in that position. Broodmother finally showing up, getting some LCS. Well, 6 CS, 7 actually now. It's not looking much better. And the Dazzle actually trying to grab some experience in the mid, but he gotta be careful. Like, if the Viper just punches you with a poison attack, then you just cannot run away. You can just try to Shadowcrave TP out, which is possible easily with the Shadowcrave level 2. You also got a TP, that shouldn't be a problem. The Shadow Fiend really in full jungle mode at this point, 8 minutes in, and it doesn't seem to change. He even stacks up now. I'm not so sure if that's really the right thing to do. Maybe they should start a rotation where the Shadow Fiend maybe is involved.
Quite possibly. I mean, the damage you can get from level 4 raises is considerable, but he still does need items. He's only just got his chainmail for a buckler, so we're looking for the mech on the Shadow Fiend in some form of recovery here. But you look for a mech on a Shadow Fiend when, in comparison, the Viper has 500 gold available. He's already got his Ring of Regen, Headdress, Buckler recipe. He's not missing much from a full mech on this Viper.
Yep, definitely. I mean, oh, there is a go on the Broodmother. Like, they should have vision, and yeah, that is definitely no way for the Broodmother to actually escape anywhere. She's just making some circles around the tree, but thanks to the Lashwag, they're gonna get the damage in they need it. There is a rotation now into the mid after they saw they cannot do anything for the Spider. They see the Shadow Fiend farming, but he's going back to the mid. Spike not coming out. Also, the Beastmaster is here. He's not quite level 6, so the counter engagement is not really happening. There's the ball, and that should also be his level 6 under the tower. So it's very, very dangerous to dive into this one here.
Indeed, it's dangerous, but as far as my opinion on this goes, Energy Pacemaker just falling too far behind in terms of experience as well as gold. I mean, you've only just got your roar available at 9.5 minutes near enough. It's quite a bad thing when that happens as a Beastmaster. You want to be getting that earlier 6, you want to be moving around the map, using and abusing your roar where needed. And now consider this, who does he roar, who does he kill? No chance on the Viper. You go for the Brood, possibly, if you've got the detection, but they don't really need to kill the Brood anymore. They need to kill the Gyrocopter. And the Gyrocopter is pretty much happy as dandy up here. There's no way they're going to be able to catch Zinkyu if he's this far back in his own jungle. Not without aggressive smoke rotations.
Yep, definitely. Well, the Broodmother is still trying to just micro a bit with her Spiderlings. As soon as the Lashrak actually leaves the lane, she can go full YOLO on that lane, and then also the push is really fast happening. The Lashrak at the moment just grabbing that bounty rune. I think he's going back there. And this is also gonna be like a very, very fast bloodstone for him. He is, yeah, he's pretty much almost there. It's just a recipe and some gold on top of it that he actually needs. And well, at least the Broodmother is not feeding the spiderlings. At the moment she's just using the jungle, the radiant jungle, to get her spiders fed a bit. Which is, I guess, the same alternative Old Chicken is doing at the moment. The aggressive warding from Tong Fu at the moment, I like it, because they see every single time there is a rotation coming out onto the tier 1 or tier 2 towers on bottom. I think there is finally the fight. The Gyroker coming in, but there is a defensive disruption as well as the curse of the Lashrak makes it out, but well, I don't think he's actually making it. He's gonna get that stun on the Gyroker, dishing as much as damage out, and finally Old Chicken is in there, and even the Beastmaster just used that stun, his ultimate roaring in already a dead man's face. Well, the Broodmother is visible here. She's trying to TP out, but nah, there is nothing they can do. Nothing to interrupt after that roar was out. So it's a 2-for-1 trade.
2-for-1 trade, and they got the big kill. They got the kill on the Gyrocopter, which to me is worth a bit more than pretty much everything else when you think about it. Keeping that Gyro down is going to be ideal, but while this goes on, you get that split push from that Viper in the mid lane, and they lose their tier 1. So this fight was, in my opinion, quite heavily in Tongfu's favor. 2 kills and a tier 1, the math just adds up in their favor.
Yep, definitely. 12 minutes into it, we have to see who actually gets the next runes, and those runes, they could be quite significant, because now we start, yeah, into that phase of the game where the Chinese teams usually start to smoke. Having a double damage or haste or something like that before, that would be of course great. The Viper's not even going for it, she's really just a stable force here in that mid, a constant reminder of how bad that lane actually was for Old Chicken. He, however, gets an invisibility rune. Problem is, well, he can use it once plus a charge and then has enough for a Requiem. Maybe with that Requiem he can just blow someone off. The Spiderling, the little Broodmother, might be low in HP. Actually, the Undying comes here. That might be interesting. What is he doing? It is... Oh, there's the slow. The ultimate is coming through and the races. He gets the Tombstone, but the problem is they don't have time to destroy the Tombstone. The Spiderlings are already on the Shadow Demon. He has nothing left. Spawn Spiderlings out of the corpse. So Shadow Fiend makes it out, more or less. And then the Shadow Fiend, the Shadow Demon is the one who has to suffer on the other end.
This is what I was saying in the draft. If the Broodmother gets on top of a Shadow Demon, the Shadow Demon has no recourse to escape if he's not got disruption, and that only buys him 2 seconds. This is what they need to do with the Brood. They need to assert control of the enemy jungle. Not an easy feat, mind you. And then hunt the squishier supports. We do go for a Midas, however, on this Broodmother, so she's investing
bad,
to the late game. No, I don't think it's bad. They want to take this game more late, and it will give that Broodmother a good chunk of experience and level boost as well in terms of its use effect.
Well, many pro players say Midas is good in pretty much every situation. If you're behind, it helps you to catch up. If you're ahead, it
gets you more ahead.
Yes, exactly. You just solidify your lead. For the Broodmother, it's definitely the first one. She is behind. Now she is actually catching up with the Broodlings, with the Spiderlings, Spider Broodlings, whatever. Oh, Lashrak, actually he's killing all the Broodlings, but the problem is after that he's pretty much going down. At the moment that's not quite the case, but with the cooldown, the first hit is not enough, the second one should just do it. They dive really deep on the tower, but no one is there to punish them, because the Dazzle and the rest of the gang, they are busy blowing up that Viper, so it's pretty much a core for a core. Only problem I have is, of course, EP, they cannot really go as fast on a tier 1 tower as they can, because this is a, yeah, spotless transition into tier 1. Cliff might be used, and they will replicate this in the mid, but there is already, like, yeah, the Undying coming in. Tombstone is not there, so he can't really do that much except for Decay spam.
And if he gets caught by a disruption, he could potentially go down if he's not careful. Shadow Poison's starting to go out. It's going to be the tier 1 for the tier 1 again by the looks of this. And still, we could get rotation through. Tongfu's starting to look to threaten. Here's the Gyrocopter. That's a big threat. That's going to force him back. And a denied tower. So, a tower for a deny. Quite heavily in favor of Tongfu there.
Yep, absolutely. They get definitely at least gold wise the better trade out of this. But oh well, everything considered, I guess EP is just fine that they traded at all. It could have been much worse. There are some more stacks actually happening now for the Shadow Fiend. Old Chicken, he will push out, I guess, till the river, maybe the next creep wave, and then he will move back. He kind of caught up now. I mean, he got the mech finished. They're kind of fight ready. And also the Viper, you saw it. He also had the mech. He's really tanky, but if he gets caught out in position and he dies just as fast. What I was surprised is that the Lashhead, for example, survived that long. And also lucky for him is that before he got ganked, he didn't have the Bloodstone. So he actually grabbed the Bloodstone after he died, or rather he bought out everything he needed for the Bloodstone while he was dying. So he actually has now 8 charges, and he can pretty much say, okay, I did not lose anything there except for my life. And let's see what else is happening. The Broodmother taking more and more possession of this jungle.
Yep, and all of those spiders happily feed that Shadow Fiend. That was quite a big raise. Hell, that would just got him, what, at least 300 gold. That was quite nice.
Well, that's the downside of a Broodmother. Like, the broodlings are actually worth something. But there's a
Yep.
tombstone, and look at the Leshrac in the front lines. He's actually hexed before he can activate anything, but, well, the cooldown. Nice positioning for that one, but now also the Shadow Fiend going full ham. No Requiem, that actually did serious damage, but the raises hurt quite a lot. Everything has been used already. Stick charges now used on the Shadow Fiend. He actually gets the Viper, but the problem is the tombstone still standing, and the zombies. The zombies are just getting you. The raises on death. On the gyrocopter, beautiful aim here by Old Chicken, and they still try to find the zombies. But look at the zombies! The zombies are just doing it. Then in the end, it was still not enough steam behind the zombie army. They're gonna get the tombstone, even D-Ward, and that was a big fat fight for EP.
4 kills, no deaths. That is on. Well, they did lose the Leshrac, but that is honestly what you want to be seeing in these fights. I mean, that kind of power and defense onto that Shadow Fiend. The Shallow Grave, I believe, was used on the Leshrac when he was going very aggressive.
Yeah.
You had good damage split from the Chain Lightning, from the, more importantly, Pulse Nova. That did so much damage to the supports. It was just a well-thought-out, well-positioned fight for NG Pacemaker.
And I'm not sure about the Lion Finger, but I think the Lion Finger went into not anything of consequence, but I wasn't sure. It was like such a mix-up in that fight. Yeah, by 120% by zombies and yeah, I mean, the amount of zombies on the Shadow Fiend there, that was completely ridiculous. I have no idea how he survived, but it was every cooldown he used a stick, I think twice in that. Of course, the mech, he was healed by the Shadow Wave multiple times, had tons of armor actually by the Weave, thanks to the Weave. And somehow he really survived. It was so on the edge. The gyrocopter tried to like dance around the races that come out, but in the end, twice fake casting, and the third time was the lucky charm, and he actually got the gyrocopter on the way back because he also had no BKB left. Well, actually, the BKB came after the fight, I think. But yeah, it doesn't even matter. The race just killed him.
Yeah, those raises did so much work in that one, and I think it's time we turn our attentions to that top lane. It seems Energy Pacemaker want to roll with that momentum and start pressuring the Tier 1 tower up here, which is probably the wisest call they can make. They've got
oh,
an
and
advantage
Bloodstone,
now.
By the way. Yeah, that's what I forgot. Like, that was the third source of healing, or the fourth source of healing. Like, that nice little heal spike, that was thanks to the Bloodstone by the Leshrac. So that's, like, that all added up,
top
that
lane.
Made
Hold down.
Up.
Weave. They're trying to get some good damage onto Lee, and he will get Shallow Graved up last second. Xingqiu trying to finish him off. Can't quite manage it quite yet. But UU9 goes to town, killing off that Dazzle, and they'll get the Gyrocopter, that extra kill on the Shadow Demon as soon as that Shallow dropped. Nice defense coming out of Tongfu. And now maybe they can force some map control themselves, push in this top lane, maybe chip away at that Tier 2 a little bit.
Yeah, actually quite a good job there by the Lion. I think he interrupted both TPs, one with the Earth Spike, the second one with the Hex, so both of them tried to do the beautiful play and just TP out in front of your enemy. Did not work, and all the Beastmaster and Shadow Fiend, they just ran for their life because they knew that fight is not gonna go anywhere. Well, problem we have is now, of course, a bit pressure on the Tier 2 tower. Without a creep wave, however, that's not gonna last for very long, unless, of course, the Gyrocopter is willing to take more damage. It really looks like it. They force out the cliff.
But with the Glyph forced, they're just going to come in as a full defense and force back these Tongfu stragglers, in my opinion. But where I find interesting points now is with this lion. Cabu got himself his full blink dagger. Now, this is going to be pretty much the item that makes or breaks it for Tong Fu. If they can make good use of these blink hexes, then, well, they can start taking good gank fights. But the problem is, the lion, if he's seen, or if he gets jumped himself, he's not going to have any form of defense or recourse right now. He's walking around with just tranquils and a blink. If anything sees him, or even sneezes in his general direction and he can't escape, Cabu's going to be toast pretty damn quickly, especially with the damage capable from Energy Pacemaker. Raises, Chain Lightnings, Roar, Axes even now. Well, Axes are at level 1, but points are going to be going into that next. Still, order of business will be Roshan for Tong Fu. And with Roshan, who do they put the Aegis on? And more importantly, will they even get this Aegis as we have a wraparound from behind? Oh, Energy Pacemaker, they see this. They roar the Broodmother up on that high ground. She's not going to be able to get away, but in comes a Requiem. That's going to at least force everyone back. No, cancel the Requiem last second. Doesn't get a good one, as it seems I'm getting quite a bit of lag, but ZinQ will manage to finish off that Beastmaster. The cooldown doing some good work. Oh, Kitten trying to get in the fight, but he'll fall as well. They just cannot stand.
Yep. It's a big fat fight for Tong Fu here. It's the typical tombstone on the high ground. You cannot get the tombstone down. Everything is just insanely clutch in this area. And when it comes to clutch fights, unfortunately, Tong Fu have the better cards. EP completely underestimated that, ran in. They were scouted out by the Broodmother. The Broodmother was stunned on the high ground, so there was also no way of reaching her reliably, and you just saw it, a 10 second BKB by the Gyrocopter, him going full ham, even like defensive disruptions not helping there, him in the front line, so the Lashrak doesn't do any crazy damage except for a Diabolic Edict, also not helping, and in the end, well, that's the outcome. Easy Roshan, nice trade for them, being ahead now in kills, and I think we should also have like a big fat plummet in the graph, and yeah, there you go. From a relatively even game, we go down to almost a 5k lead now for Tong Fu, and as I know Tong Fu, they're probably gonna try to just, you know, swim on that wave of advantage now with the Aegis top. We have some split push coming here by the Lashrak, quite an effective one, because this is a level 3 Edict already. But then again, there's the tombstone, and the pressure is actually happening. Whoa, these are many, many spiderlings.
They all die to one raise. That's the biggest problem with spiderlings. But still, this should be an easy tier 2 forced. And it seems like I'm getting quite a bit of lag again. You have luck.
Ah, you lag with your UK connection. Okay, mine is totally fine today. Either way,
you're not getting any perfect world lag. That's what it looks like to me.
Yes, exactly. No, my server is completely fine. Perfect world is perfect for me. Except for yesterday. Sometimes the servers send you some crazy update. It says uncompressed update in the console, and then you start lagging like hell. Sometimes reconnect actually helps there. Either way, the Broodmother keeps sitting here in that radiant jungle, but, well, not much actually happening with that. It's just really the spiderlings doing here and there some stuff. If the Dazzle was alone, the Broodmother would probably go for it. With the Shadow Fiend, that's probably too much. But, well, it's the typical Broodmother situation. You have vision, free vision, you control the enemy jungle where your enemy cannot farm freely. And that really sucks, because look at the Shadow Fiend. Old Chicken, he would be so happy if there was anything in his jungle to take. He's going from camp to camp, but it's not really happening. Now they found her with the dust, and well, she can turn around and try to do something. Tries to actually burst down that Dazzle. Nice, successful. So I've just been talking about it. But yeah, in the end, she goes down. It's still not much of a setback, because also in the meantime, Tong Fu is farming. So that's totally fine with him.
Yeah, especially when they're taking the enemy's ancient stack. This is a considerable amount of gold going away in ZinQ. I mean,
was it a
three,
stack?
Four? No, it was a three stack.
Oh, okay, a triple stack going their way. So that's I don't know, like 700, 600 gold, something like that. That really hurts, not to mention the XP. I mean, they didn't get everything. Like, the big ones are still there. But yeah, it definitely hurts. The Gyrocopter, of course, the best here to sneak something like that. And in the worst case scenario, he still had the Aegis. That's also the reason Tong Fu can play that ballsy. Usually, we have Chinese teams being more like the cautious kind. With the Aegis, they suddenly become really, really ballsy.
Well, ballsy overzealous play. We've seen it so many times where that can be the death of you in a game. More than once, even with an Aegis. I mean, over aggression.
What is that lion doing here?
He's hiding, he's waiting. Blink X, in comes. They go straight for the Leshrac. He dies and with the cooldown, all of that damage going straight on that Beastmaster. He's not going to survive either. Now it's Old Chicken having to run, and there's no way Old Chicken can go 1v1 versus ZQ. Or can he? Well, he's going to try for it, certainly, but I can't see Old Chicken winning this, and I can see ZQ killing off this Shadow Fiend in no time at all. Viper's even rotating in, and he has that Viper Strike ready to go.
No, there was just no way. The Viper rotating in there, that would have been the end of Old Chicken if he really wanted to go for that fight. I mean, right-click-wise, they're pretty much on the same level, but if you have right-click plus fighting the Rocket Barrage, which is now on level 4, which is the original damage, then, yeah, that's not really a fight you want to go for. The Leshrac, surprisingly enough, not tanky enough for all of this. I mean, they have things to play around with, like the Disruption, like the Yule Scepter, and still he dies in those fights like nothing. That cannot happen. Like, the positioning of the Tombstone, this is absolutely amazing. There's just no way you can fight into this or kill him. Ultimate on Old Chicken. This is more or less a harass. I don't think this is actually going to lead to a kill, but it forces him back into the fountain, or forcing him to use the max, something like that. There's even a zoning cooldown. Is this a zoning cooldown? I think he wants more, but there's a disruption. Maybe there's a Requiem setup, but no, into the BKB. This is a 7-second one, I think, yes. And they at least drove them away from the tier 3 tower. Now there's the slow on the Viper. He's trying to TP out, but there is, well, a Yule Scepter. They don't even need the Roar. Or is the Roar coming out? No, the Roar is safe for something else. The question is, does he find anything? Plinktech are not up on him. He went for the Medallion. So that's too bad. They're not going to find the Undying, which would be a good kill with the gem on him.
The Undying would certainly be a very nice kill, but it's one of the harder ones to get, considering he's at least hanging back most of the time. He is pretty tanky for an Undying. He does have that urn as well as a medallion, which is a nice bit of armor himself. But item-wise, the curious one I have to bring up, what's your opinion of this? The Dagon on the Broodmother, what's actually the win rate of Dagon Broodmother in the pro scene, I wonder?
Yeah, well, the Broodmother, she didn't really do much, to be honest. Like, barely any damage on the tier 3 tower, but the fact is, they were so occupied with that fight, you saw already what can happen if the Broodmother actually gets some items, like a little army of Spiderlings. That will sooner or later be the case, which means if EP really commits to a 5-man fight somewhere, regardless of the outcome, it could be good or bad, but the fact is, the Broodmother will actually make dents in your base, in your towers, in your racks, whatever it is. Even now, the Broodmother is, for example, skipping, so just in case EP plan to push, you can pretty much forget about this, because there we go. Now she's TPing out because, well, is EP actually on the way trying to find her? I guess that's the thought he had.
But if they could have killed the Brood, that would have been nice. But killing the Brood, even when he's skipping like that, is very hard. As you see, all it takes is one TP. There's no hope. Even popping dust, they're just looking for any remnant of the spider, and they're not going to find it. But more importantly for Energy Pacemaker, I look at the Shadowfiend, I see components of a Skadi. In fact, he's got enough money for the second ultimate orb, so he's nearly there. And with the Skadi on Old Chicken, they can look to stand and fight one hell of a lot better.
And what is coming out for that Gyrocopter? There's the Eaglesong. So he's gonna get a butterfly pretty much soon. And that is bad for the Shadowfiend, because the Shadowfiend is going tanky. He's going for the Eye of Skadi. That's at least what it looks like at the moment. So yes, you have the Eye of Skadi and you have some raises, but still, in a one-on-one situation, the Gyrocopter is way, way ahead of that Shadowfiend, and that's of course very worrisome. 4k ahead in net worth, probably a bit more now after the double ancient stack here. The Viper as such, I'm kind of disappointed, because where is his farm after he had such a good start? I mean, he had that early mech, now he went... Did he go after the mech for Midas?
Yes, he did. Now, Jesus, he's got a Blink Dagger flying out to him as well. So, Blink Viper. He's there for the heal, he's there to slow down the Shadowfiend. That's all they wanted the Viper for. And to be honest, Viper Strike against a Shadowfiend isn't exactly a bad thing.
Well, we have an initiation by the lion first. That's the biggest problem right now. Dagon Mother is also coming out, level 3, and yeah, these Midases are also ticking. Right now, with Blink Dagger, they could actually just jump on the Shadowfiend. I don't think the Shadowfiend has a chance to actually die, to survive. Well, he has high chances to die if the lion jumps in with the Hex. He might not even get the BKB off in the worst case scenario, but Tongfu did decide to just go back The game looks relatively close when you look at the score, but looking at the graphs at the moment, like the net worth lead of Dong Fu is quite heavy. It's nothing you cannot turn around by a like a good fight. I mean, hell, in the previous game, EP versus Newbie, we had a 30,000 swing. So everything is possible, but I mean, I don't think we're gonna see that in every game right now. Newbie just did that little turn, now they're back into mid.
I think one of the bigger pickups for Energy Pacemakers actually this plate mail on the Leshrac. That's going to give him quite a bit more armor into the next fight, and it'll most likely be built into a Shiva's Guard. And a Shiva's Guard against Kung Fu, pretty good. But now with Blink Hex onto Old Chicken, but no. Hey, get the disruption. That's going to keep him alive. BKB's used by both cores. Now it'll cool down. They're throwing everything into this mix, and my lag has got too much, so Hepler.
Well, we have to see where this one is going. At the moment, no one is actually diving further than that, but I don't even think they want to. Like, Tombstone was used, Cooldown was used, relatively small cooldowns as such. I mean, a Tombstone is, how much is it? It's 1 minute, right? And 45 on a cooldown, yes. So you can actually spam that both pretty much every minute. And yeah, everything was spammed, getting the tier 2 tower and back off. Totally fine. You even get a BKB charge off the Shadow Fiend on top of it. Well, the Gyrocopter used his 7 second ones now and is almost down to 5 with the next fight, but still, the value out of it is just much better.
What you were saying about the cooldown and the tombstone, this is something I like from this kind of draft decision. They can fight often, and they will fight often. They use this kind of aggression just to maintain control of the map, and it's a very, very high-paced style of Dota, which is a hell of a lot more entertaining to watch, in my opinion.
Yep, and Roshan, it's gonna happen, but this one is gonna be so soon. There's just no way EP can actually contest this. They try to do some split push, at least getting a tier 2 trade for Roshan at the moment. Well, they're gonna slow this down with a cliff, but I think the T2 was anyway everything they wanted. They're not gonna go for T3 or anything else. The Lion, however, in the front lines, he's already like very willing to scout. Only, well, a little dangerous thing is he is also a gem carrier at this point, which is of course bad, because if he really jumps forward and the initiation is not as clean as it should be, he's gonna lose the gem. Which is of course bad, because then you have your Broodmother exposed all the way. Then again, the Broodmother, I mean, she's not the typical Broodmother. She's not that persistent, like this constant in a lane. She's just farming, also joining the big fights when they try to break a tower. So she's very flexible, different from other Broodmothers.
I suppose, but it just being me, I don't like the Dagon. But now it's a Dagon 5? Yes, a Dagon 5. I don't know, Midas Dagon just seems really one shot to me. Either the Brood goes in and just annihilates one of the supports, or the Brood gets caught and throws the Dagon out in, I suppose, in hope of getting a kill. I mean, doesn't even scratch the Shadow Fiend that much anymore.
Oh, actually, I have to disagree there, because look at their HP. They have 1k on the Shadow Fiend, on the Shadow Demon, and we have less than that, even 900 on the Dazzle. And that's still plus minus magic resistance, still 30 to 40% of their HP pool, given that there's cooldown and flak cannon and whatnot, and zombies on you that also get empowered when you're low HP. That's still a value pick, not to mention that she can really use it on such a low cooldown when they siege. When they actually siege the base, the Brute can spam that in from almost every angle, because she got like free access, like on high grounds, has no collision whatsoever. So I kinda like it. And as I said, she's playing a very flexible role. She's not like just in one lane, just pushing that lane. She's actually joining the fight, so she's adding her value to the entire thing. So that makes sense. And it's not the last item. I'm pretty sure she's going for some utility for the team pretty much soon. Just as the Undying, he just finished the Vladimir's. So that's even more damage and armor and everything for the team, as well as lifesteal. So overall, that helps. And the Gyrocopter, man, he's 5-slotted pretty much. He just, okay, let's say 4-slotted, because he still needs to finish that into a Satanic, and then the last slot is merely for the Aegis slot, pretty much.
Well, on the topic of team support items, we got a Solar Crest up for the Beastmaster, which is certainly going to help out the end of the Pacemaker lineup, but for this Brood, I get the distinct feeling that we might see okay, we get the full power droids. I was going to say I get a distinct feeling we may see a E-Blade.
Nah, E-Blade I think would be a tiny bit overkill. Then again, I guess Why not? You can even save your allies if you want
Exactly. You
to.
can save your lion, you can, well, maybe not necessarily save him because of the Leshrac, but you can at least stop the Shadowfiend right from here. Now, here we go. Call down. They're going to go aggressive once again, trying to burst down on Chicken. He's down to half, but now comes all of that healing, which is what just keeps that Daemon so low. Now in comes the Sheba's Guard. They're fighting under the tombstone a little bit, but they're going to force it back. If they can finish this tombstone, then maybe look to defend.
They
that
need
can
to kill
work.
That tombstone.
Yeah, they need to kill that tombstone, and they're still losing their tier 3. And on top of that, they're going to lose Lee to the damage of Xingqiu, and now they're going to look to try to bring down this Beastmaster, forced up away by him. And Old Chicken trying to go to town, finish off this Viper, but that's not exactly the easiest feat. There comes out a Roar, going to try to buy some time, but Xingqiu now going to be the next victim at this rate. One BKB pop by Old Chicken, and he's just bringing down everyone he can. Dagon used by Bingo, he's going to finish off the Leshrac, but now, well, Xingqiu's back. He had that Aegis, and he's going to look to stand and fight. They managed to get the tier 3, but now, well, Cabu comes in, gets that Blink Hex combination onto Old Chicken, and he's most likely going to go down here. The Shallow Grave's going to buy some time. Raises, but it's not enough. Xingqiu picks up the Mega. Down goes that Shadow Fiend, but now Xingqiu will pay for it with his life. He goes down a second time, and in comes the Lash. He's going to burn everyone with that Pulse Nova. That's two kills. Can we get a third? No. The Broodmother gets out low health.
Well, still, Tongfu, they did so much damage there. It's just amazing. I'm kind of amazed by the fact that they still managed to get that defense together. EP, it was at the cost of the Leshrac buyback, pretty much. So it's a 3-for-3 trade plus a buyback. Still, you saw that, I don't know, the entire thing is really shifting towards Tongfu advantage right now. Of course, it was with the Aegis, but the Requiem of Souls, yes, our statsman even says it. It was on very large range to the Aegis respawn point, and it just glimpsed the gyrocopter pretty much, because the Broodmother is under the net, just way, way too fast. So she escaped pretty much everything that came out of the Shadow Fiend there. You also kind of doubted the Dagon value, Dagon responsible for two kills, finishing them off just before they were actually about to escape into their fountain. So yes, the Dagon value is confirmed, pretty much.
I look at it and it just doesn't look right in my mind, but I suppose point proven. My biggest issue with it, though, is sure, you can burst down the supports, but there is so much healing available for Energy Pacemaker. It just feels negligible in my mind.
Well, negligible. No, I don't think so. Like, 3 times used in this fight, it's a big damage source if you consider that's like I don't know, triple the HP of a Shadow Demon. Either way, it doesn't really matter. The fact is they get the tier 3 tower down. It's a typical Chinese style, like, going head first into some of the fights, especially when you have the Aegis. It's worth suiciding if you take enough siege damage with you, which I guess they did. It's a tier 3 tower. I think Tongfu, they wanted more out of this, but with the buyback on the Leshrac and his also very good position after the buyback, that was not possible anymore. But still, like, they're gonna go try to find some more kills. You have a Broodmother, so at least one lane, maybe even two, will be pushed in. She might even hijack the jungle again, so decreasing EP's farm over time. And yeah, you even see that EP is so scared at the moment, nobody is leaving the base. They are, like, locked in, completely locked in.
I suppose that's what happens when you've got so much power coming down towards your base. They've got the Blink Hex, you've got the Tombstone, call down, more importantly, the damage out of this Gyrocopter, who's now got SNY, BKB, Butterfly. He's got so much damage on this Gyrocopter. And I suppose there is the Dagon Brood, who can burst down the supports. Dagon Brood just feels so wrong saying it, Hevler.
I see you're not happy with this game. It's just, I think your affinity to spiders is playing with you, Mr. Blackadder.
I suppose no one likes spiders.
Either way, Tongfu is gonna take another round, and this time it's a central approach directly into, the mid lane, I guess. Maybe they're gonna actually shift around, then try to go into bottom, or maybe they try to take a crack on that Leshrac, which TP's out, however, which is also a good thing, because look at the Gyrocopter, very swift, that friend, 480 movement speed, he replaced the face boots a long time already ago with BOTs, so he can be wherever he wants to be. Also the TP, BKB is definitely possible in case he gets caught out. there, however, just pushing all three lanes in, making sure something is really happening. The Leshrac, however, is really trying to be exactly the counterforce. So wherever Chung Fu is, he's trying to counter push, so they have at least one option that, like, Fan is the one who is, like, getting the split push in. And Chung Fu is like, nah, we don't really dare to. Roshan is far, far away, I think. No, actually, not that far. But still, is it really what Chung Fu wants? Wait for Roshan and then go for the next try?
I think that might be the wisest decision. I mean, Roshan, he's going to be up in less than a minute. It's going to be the most safe play they can make, especially if they give it to the Gyrocopter. The Gyro can stand and fight better than any of these heroes, even than the Viper, which that takes a lot of saying. Then again, the Viper did build for a very mobile, very team-oriented build instead of your usual, I'm going to be the tankiest one on this team. I mean, there's no Aghanims, no Heart, no... Well, the only item you've got really that's increasing his health is the BKB, outside of the boots. It's a very interesting way to play the Viper, and I like this. It just gives you the ability to Viper Strike whoever needs to be struck. In this case, the Shadow Fiend.
Yep, and we're gonna get a BKB on the Broodmother, so she's actually becoming more and more a solid force into those fights. Because, I mean, once she's locking on a target with the lifesteal of the ultimate especially, then... she's becoming very, very inconvenient. There's not much you can actually do against her. And since that BKB is also coming out at the relatively late time of this game, I mean 41 minutes, it's flying in right now, I think. Yes, it's flying in right now. So suddenly, right at the time where you break High Crown, someone is coming up with a new, fresh 10-second BKB. While the Gyrocopter, for example, he has to deal with the fact that he's only on his 5-second one. That's, of course, a tiny bit downside. But he doesn't care that much, because he's gonna have Aegis, and we have, I don't know, who's gonna take the cheese? Are they gonna put it on the Viper? So, Viper also, I mean, the Viper is tanky by nature already. Tanky because he had an amazing game so far. With the Plink Dagger, he's really just gonna, like, plink forward and get in a central spot, pop in the cheese if needed. That is a semi-Aegis, pretty much, for him. And the Gyrocopter will then pretty much do the rest. Now, with the Spider, fresh 10-second BKB, all this added up, and put in a pot that boils down to a horrible soup.
Well, I think we're going to be forcing the high ground. With this Aegis, it should be a very easy one for the Chung Fu lineup to be able to take the Raxan, I believe, but the Tombstone already going down. That's going to buy them some time, and I seem to be lagging ahead in Heffler.
Oh, well, at the moment, the Dagon and the Spawn Spiderling just drive the Dazzler out. He survives with barely anything, 100 HP. They try to get the stun on the Gyrocopter, that actually misses. Now, finally, Old Chicken joining the fight here, but they don't care. They're like, okay, we just focused at Melirex. There's finally the Cliff coming out, but also the Climacate helping him a tiny bit. So, new Sentry Ward, and it seems like Chung Fu, they wait for another round. The next creep wave is coming in. There's a nice little Earth Spike. Actually, the Gyrocopter feels this is the opportunity, coming in with the cooldown, but not doing too much damage. The next Flak Cannon is another 8 seconds away. So in the meantime, we have Shadow Fiend trying to really manfight this, but there's a 10-second BKB of the Spider, not doing as much as I expected. Now, Viper manfighting Old Chicken, he's getting supported, even the Aegis is being down. Chung Fu is running at the moment in real trouble, but they get the Rex already down. Now it's really about how much can get EP out of this. Well, the kill on the Lion should actually happen with the projectile following, and they want more. They want simply more. There is a double slow. They even have a Yule Scepter. They just need to get in a position, but oh my god, nice little hide behind a tree and back home. So bottom line is, you lose 4, you lose your Aegis, but you got a Melirax.
The Melirax, though, could be the tipping point in this game.
Oh, look at this, top, the Leshrac. Yeah. Going full Yule on the Gyrocopter.
Yeah, he can actually kill the Gyro as well with this Pulse Nova if he lands a stun. Hell, he didn't even need to land the stun, but Fan will get brought down by UUU9, and that'll at least force a bit of response out of the Chung Fu lineup. I don't think they expected the tier 3 to suddenly come under siege, but when you consider the strength of this Leshrac, Octarine Core, Shiva's Guard, Yules, he has that kind of power.
Yeah, I mean, it's actually good, because with that it was a full team wipe, and they forced a buyback on the Viper, which is kind of a good thing. That puts them now in a position where they don't have to fear a cooldown and a Flak Cannon to defend this tier 2 tower. Easy tower for Old Chicken, that is. The question now, is there more to happen? I doubt it, because even with the Gyrocopter down there, they have still a decent defense. So is that something Chung Fu can repeat forever, like really running headfirst into barracks and then brute forcing it down? Because at some point you're out of buybacks, and it seems like EP really wants to wait for that perfect comeback. I mean, they proved against Newbie that they can stall out a game for like 20 to 30 minutes and then suddenly start a comeback that is from another planet. We had that today and we might have that again. Look at Tongfu's net worth. They were heading towards a 10k advantage and then this fight came, dropping down to almost 2.5, which is nothing. Which is nothing but like a simple pick-off, anything like that. A failed fight, and suddenly EP is ahead. And you saw also the stand of the Shadow Fiend in the last fight. I mean, he was just standing there like a man, you know, letting just Dong around and showing everyone how big it is. It's... wow.
Where were you going with that sentence?
I stopped myself saying the
thing, but... Yeah, I think so. I can pretty much sum up like this. I think the only reason Tongfu went for that kind of, yeah, we want your Rax push, is they already have Brood Webs down there. They already have beaten the Tier 3 and exposed the Rax. I can't see them trying that kind of strategy against, say, the mid or top lanes. The Tier 3s are still standing. They have no Webs set up already. Sure, you can get Webs down a lot quicker these days, but I have to consider, when it comes to NG Pacemaker, their comeback potential is certainly real, but I look at the Shadow Fiend, I look at the Leshrac. Where do they go item-wise from here? Shadow Fiend just sold off his stick and another item, his Aquila. He managed to pick up a Dominator and a TP scroll, so we're going to be looking for a Satanic on Old Chicken, which will be phenomenal in this game in my mind. You've already got your Skadi, and now, well, a Satanic, bursts of health back, that's going to be absolutely perfect. Leshrac, though, what does he really go for next? Does he just upgrade his travels to Tier 2? No, he's going to be going for a Scythe Device. And this Scythe Device, well, who can he catch? Pretty much anyone. Speaking of Hexes, though, goes on to Old Chicken. He's going to get Hexed in the cooldown, but a defensive disruption is going to keep him alive. Now all of that damage being done. Requiem finds up. Zinkyu takes so much damage. He's just being shredded. Leshrac is standing in the middle of this as well. With that Pulse Nova going, everyone is falling to this kind of magical damage. The Finger of Death thrown onto Old Chicken. Disruption defensively again. He's going to buy some time, and Old Chicken still stands after all of this, and Fan is just going in the enemy's face all the damn time, killing everyone he can. Brood and Gyro are the only ones remaining alive, and they're forced to retreat.
Yeah, the Gyrocopter bought back, but like the entire team fell so fast apart that there was just no chance for him actually to rejoin the fight. Like, it's completely impossible, and now we are in suddenly that comeback position where they have no cliff, and that Leshrac is gonna push your base down so fast. Last time they had to go already for the Viper comeback. Right now they only have to worry about the Shadow Fiend. The Shadow Fiend needs to be healed up, but there's the Yule Scepter, maybe the stun on the Tricopter, but now he's gonna save himself into the BKB, and now he's trying to go ham. We have no roar, they have to wait for another 10 seconds, but oh, look at Old Chicken's damage. There we go, both of them down. This is at least one Rex, and Tongfu knows that they're not gonna stop with one Rex. They could go for more, and there is the GG, and Jesus Christ, Old Chicken, that chicken, sometimes a feeding chicken. This time it was absolutely a ballsy chicken. He's just standing there, the farm, the recovery. He lost his lane so much, and in the end, he's carrying this game through. With the Leshrac, of course, but still.
Yeah, I was certainly a show of force from NG Pacemaker, showing they can fight from behind once again, and you are quite right, that fight was all down to Old Chicken surviving. Old Chicken lives, that's all you can sum that up with, and the Leshrac just, as I say, going to town. Energy Pacemaker take game one of this series.
Yep, so that's actually the second time today that we see Energy Pacemakers on the back foot. The laning was not good for them, the mid game was not good for them. Tongfu breaks a melee barracks, and everybody's like, okay, now we're gonna see like 30 minutes of Chinese Dota, like going into Roshan, getting a Rex, going to Roshan, getting a Rex. And EP was like, no, guys, no, we're not gonna do this. We just wait for the good fight. Return this, Leshrac playing there a big role, especially with applying the pressure, because if it wasn't about that Viper buyback, that fight might have been different, the defense might have been different, but yeah, this way, easy going. Well, so congrats to EP, we're gonna go in game number 2 in just a second, guys.